While it features some absolutely spectacular performances, overall, The Get Down is a little uneven. So sadly, it's not something that I would say everyone has to watch all the way through. But it is something I would recommend everyone try, because you might be surprised just how much you in particular like The Get Down. Now, what I mean by that is that, for instance, someone like myself, and I'm sure many of you watching, are not in the target audience for this show. And I know many of you don't like hearing that pieces of entertainment have a target audience. But the truth of the matter is that they do. Now, of course, the holy grail in entertainment is to have something that's a four quadrant piece of entertainment, which basically means it has universal appeal. But that's a rarity. And even then, there's still a target audience that you rely on a little bit more as your engine, right? Like, you hope that it becomes a four quadrant film, or it has the strong potential to become a four quadrant, you know, television event, but in reality, you know, your foundation is still that target demographic. And honestly, I am not the target demographic of The Get Down, but since I like Stranger Things so much, I was like, I'm gonna try it. Also, the night it debuted, I saw it trending on Twitter, and I was like, oh, people seem to be enjoying this. I like Baz Luhrmann, I like Shameik Moore and Dope. I'm gonna try it. And there was enough good elements, as I said, in particular the performances, that I watched it all the way through. And I'm very glad that I did. And when it returns for part two, this is the first half of the story, I will definitely be there to see how it continues to unfold. Because who knows if they'll continue to make this show or not. But I really, really enjoyed parts of it, which we're going to discuss right now. But just so you know, the first half of this review does not feature spoilers. But then the second half, when I talk about the characters in particular, will feature spoilers. But don't worry, I'll let you know when those spoilers are kicking in. All right, so let's get started. And I think that the thing that I think is the most exciting about The Get Down is that it represents yet another opportunity, not just for Black talent, and, you know, basically, because there's a lot of Latino talent on display here as well. Let's just say non-white talent, and not just non-white talent overall, but up-and-coming white talent. It used to be, very recently, that, you know, there I would see a lot of discussion in the comment section and also just in articles in general about the lack of opportunity for people who wanted to be, you know, on screen in entertainment who weren't white. You know, there just really wasn't a lot of roles for you to audition for. And, you know, occasionally, like, you'd have your Sidney Poitiers, you'd have your Denzel Washingtons, you'd have your Idris Elbas, your Chiwetel Ejiofors, right? But they got, like, all the parts. So now, though, with not only Shonda Rhimes, but the show Black-ish on ABC, which was just Emmy nominated, Luke Cage coming up, the Black Panther movie, Ryan Coogler's work in general, now The Get Down, it's just so nice to see so much opportunity, not only just in the multitude of roles, but how good the roles are. And I was actually a little jealous, because I'm hoping that at some point, women have the same situation. And I'm sure there are other demographics that would also like to see this happen. I know a lot of people who are BTT viewers who are Asian, who are upset that there just isn't enough opportunity for Asian talent on camera. And I think that there's a legitimate complaint there. But it's very nice to see one group getting, you know, finally, you know, moving forward. So I think that's wonderful. So if you are, you know, are a Black or Latino actor, this is probably the best time in the history of entertainment to try and get into the business, right? It's not going to be easy, although we'll talk about Mylene a little bit later. I think she's a little bit of a fantasy story. But, you know, it's probably the best odds that have ever been available in the history, again, of entertainment. So now, as for the actual quality of The Get Down, it's very uneven. I felt that Baz Luhrmann did a great job directing that first hour and a half episode, but I think that the other directors working on the project couldn't really meet the same level of quality. And there were a couple of episodes where I was not enjoying it as much as I think I could have been. I thought the first episode was the best. I really liked that a lot. Like, by the end of the first episode, I was sold on watching the rest of it. And the weaker episodes couldn't shake me. I really liked the third episode for all the reveals that were, unveiled. Things that I should have seen them coming because they're so soap opery, but they got me. They totally got me, which was fun. And then I really liked the sixth final episode of this first part because I loved seeing the performance by our main characters. I thought they did a great job. They're like one of the first boy bands, and I thought it was really great. But, you know, there were I can't have any spoilers, so I'll have to discuss that note a little later on. But there were a couple of things, like, well, I couldn't see some of the twists coming. There were other things that were so obvious and so cliche that it was a little frustrating having to wait for the characters to catch up to you. Now, one of the other things that I didn't like about the show was the choice of framing device with the future very successful version of Zeke performing at Madison Square Garden on a stage, you know, kind of setting up the story. Now, I didn't like this for a couple of reasons. Some of the music here I'm not a fan of. Now, maybe I'm just not a fan of all hip hop, you know, admittedly, I'm not a big hip hop or disco fan. But there are songs that I can appreciate, and there are some songs that I do appreciate here. But I did not like adult Zeke's performances. I didn't think they were particularly good. And I thought for the most part, his rhymes were a little weak. The best rhyme we'll talk about with the characters. But also I thought the production values for futuristic Zeke were also poor. I was like, this stage show sucks, Zeke. You know, like, I didn't like that. I know they're trying to, shroud him in mystery and in the shadows and everything. But, you know, for a big Madison Square event concert, other performers step up their game a lot more. Like, you've got your Beyoncés, you've got your Bruno Mars, your Taylor Swifts, your Katy Perrys. They put on a show. And I know that Zeke is supposed to be a very different performer, but still, I thought it was weak. So, especially considering how colorful and awesome the rest of the show is, it was always a downer when they would have future Zeke come in, and I was just like, you're slowing down the show's pacing big time, and you're not adding anything to it to make it worth the sacrifice. Also, mixing in real-world characters is always tricky because they have Ed Koch, and the actor playing Ed Koch is very good. And it's not particularly flattering to Ed Koch. But still, it always makes me wonder, I'm like, well, is the Jimmy Smits character who was interacting with Ed Koch so much based on a real guy? You know, I think it's dangerous to mix, you know, real-world events with fictional events, you know, unless you were, like, making it clear that, you know, you've done your real-world history, right? So I had mixed feelings about that as well. But again, the characters here are just so good, and they're also very likable. Such an incredible roster of talent. But here, before we get into spoilers, I can say that I liked that Zeke and Shaolin both have backup plans. Any good artist knows they have to have a backup plan, but I like that they've chosen such different backup plans. You know, Zeke trying to go the up and up route, and Shaolin going the criminal route, because those are the two different paths open to people in the Bronx. So that there's a poeticism to that that I really like. Speaking of art, I like the show's celebration of art. I like showing the transition from disco to hip-hop, that you're just right at that time where you're switching the type of music that is popular. I think that's really interesting. I like the idea of the DJ versus the wordsmith in terms of hip-hop, like who is more, who's the star. I think that's very interesting as well. I like the idea that it started out being the DJ, but of course we know today the wordsmith won, although it's kind of obvious from watching the show why that would be. But then also I thought that the graffiti discussion is very interesting, and the idea that graffiti doesn't exist anymore because of the political situation that developed over the course of the show. I thought that that was so interesting to see basically a style of artwork erased, literally erased from the New York landscape and voices silenced. I thought that was such a cool thing that it never occurred to me before. I wish that they hadn't kind of backburner graffiti for the music aspects of the show. I mean, I know it's a good way to get graffiti in there to have the titles of the episodes on the trains, on the subway trains. That's very nice. But I think that they introduce that element and they don't really do very much with it. So, I mean, even the artist community that Dizzee is a part of, I think they don't explore it as much as they should. Like, I don't understand graffiti the way I'm being made to understand disco and hip hop. All right, so now we're going to get into the characters, and this is where there are spoilers. So you've been warned. Now, I'm going to discuss the characters in the order of my favorites until we get to the end, where all this, like, the third tier characters are all, you know, kind of on the same level, basically. But, you know, in the beginning, this is in the order of how much I like them. And it was very hard for me to pick number one. But I had to go with Shameik Moore's Shaolin Fantastic. What a creation! I love this character. Now, first of all, I was shocked at the range that Shameik Moore has, because he very much seems like a leading man and leading men and women actors rarely have very much range because they're so strong in what they do that they become a brand, right? But Shameik Moore, I was very impressed with his range. I also liked that his character was not only original, but very nuanced, you know, really a lot of different nooks and crannies. And I liked that they had the guts to make the character very stupid. Again, we're in spoiler territory, but when his pad was burned down, I can't believe that it has not even occurred to him that Fat Annie is the one who had it burned down so that he would not be able to go and leave her, right? I'm like, seems pretty clear to me. I also think it's pretty obvious that Zeke is going to totally overshadow him as the DJ, and they keep being like, oh no, Shaolin, it's all you, you know, because Shaolin's a bad do-do-do-do-do, right? You know, it's like, how easily can you be won over, Shaolin? This guy's totally steamrolling you. But I think visually the character is so interesting, and I wonder how much is like something that Shameik Moore added. You know, it's just, you know, it's a great team effort, because I think that the Red Pumas are just such a great, the mythology they create for the character during the first episode is so good. I like that he wears the Red Pumas. I like that he's always doing the karate flips and moves. I love that they ended up like not really actually being that good, right? Like it's just like posturing. I love when he adds the cane. I think that's just some of the shots of Shameik Moore, you know, like when he's standing, when Jimmy Smits is pointing out and he's saying, it's a bunch of crabs in a barrel and they're going to pull you down. And they have that low shot of Shaolin at the side of that that orange pimp car, you know, with his cap on, swinging the cane. I was like, that is so great. And also, again, I like that he's so short. I like that making your really cool Han Solo type character, making him like much shorter than your lead is an interesting choice, and I think it really works. So I loved it. I think that Shameik Moore's Shaolin Fantastic is one of the great characters of like all time. I hope that this show becomes so popular enough that people will realize how cool his character is. But also, a kind of character like that is very rarely created for actors of color, so that's so nice that Shameik Moore had this opportunity. Now, my second favorite character is Jimmy Smits' Francisco Cruz. Wow, I've never seen Jimmy Smits this good. He is just amazing. I think he came right from NYPD Blue, right? But I mean, I never watched that show. So to me, Jimmy Smits was always like in like secondary roles, you know, Princess Leia's adopted father, et cetera, et cetera. But wow, I now get Jimmy Smits. And again, what a fantastic, nuanced role that is so not usually available to actors of color. He is the Puerto Rican godfather in this show. And every scene he does, he commands your full attention. I mean, I pity the fools who have to share the screen with Jimmy Smits' Francisco Cruz, because he's electric. Also, the Mylene twist, that's not his niece, but his daughter. Oh, did not see that coming, but yet it makes total sense because she's just so much like him. And so I'm really impressed with the show for coming up with such an organic twist, but yet being able to totally blindside me. I loved it. I was so impressed. Next up, my third favorite character, I have to go with Zeke. I think Zeke isn't as compelling as the other characters on the show, but of course he's your lead. A lot of interesting stuff is happening to him. And I think that Justice Smith, the actor who plays him, has a great voice. I think the depth of his voice really gives him a lot of extra mileage that I think that how he looks doesn't deliver. But you know who this actor is? If you saw Paper Towns, he was the black friend whose parents collected black Santa Clauses. And he was so different there. He was like this nerdy kid with glasses. So his range is also very, very good. He has a hard role to pull off. He's the leading man, you know, but he's not the Han Solo, so he's like the Luke Skywalker. Those roles are tough. They seem to be a little goody two-shoes. He has a mean, hot, rebellious streak in him, but he also has to do a lot of crying and stuff. So I don't know. He's okay. But again, I like his voice. I think most of the times, though, I'm not seeing the brilliance of the character. Everyone's like, Zeke, you're a genius. And I'm like, I think your work's okay. But I did like the poem that he did that his teacher made him read out loud about his parents' murder. That was really good. That was also very powerful. I was like, you should have read that out loud. That's amazing. And it's cool, too. Like, you weren't singing about, like, you know, going to, you know, church and, you know, returning your library books on time. It was cool. And I do like how smart the character is, and yet he still is able to be cool. I think that makes him a good role model, right? Although, I'm curious, does anyone like Zeke over Shaolin Fantastic, or is it really a Han Solo, Luke Skywalker dynamic? Although many of you have told me you prefer Luke Skywalker to Han Solo, so there must be some Zeke fans out there. All right, so next, I think you'll be surprised. Fourth is, well, you can see who I've actually, now that I think about it, I put the list up of who I'm discussing, but I bet you were surprised to see that Grandmaster Flash is number four. The actor there is Mamadou Athi, and I think that actor does a great job. I love the Grandmaster, you know, also being like a Shaolin Grandmaster. That's such a cool idea. And I love the, you know, and that actor, Mamadou Athi, is responsible for selling the mythological aspects of DJing that they're able to pull off with this show. I thought it was great. Much better framing device than the adult Zeke. Every scene with Grandmaster Flash is awesome. And he's so cool, even though at first glance he doesn't seem particularly cool, but he's great. I really love him. And as I said, I think his lines are very difficult and the way he has to deliver them is very difficult. So I'm particularly impressed that he's able to pull it off. Then I have to go with Mylene Cruz, played by Herizen F Guardiola. I think that, fair warning, I absolutely hate her songs. Now, it's nothing to do with her. I think she has a very pretty voice, but I just don't like them. I actually started fast-forwarding through some of them, you know, as we got along with the episodes, because I was like, it's late, because I was binge-watching it, and I was like, I can't stay up for this song, it hurts my ears. But I think that the actress is very sweet, very pretty, she can really rock a disco dress, and I think that she makes you a character that you really root for, despite how she's treating Zeke, and that's impressive. She seems very much like a leading lady, but a relatable leading lady, which is also hard to do. The biggest problem that I have with her storyline, besides her songs, is that I think that it's unrealistic. It's very hard to break into the music business, even with a criminal uncle with connections. And I think that, you know, the fact that Jackie Moreno never takes advantage of her, that she's able to, like, turn him around because she has a heart, you know, pure as gold, that Cadillac never forces himself on her. I mean, she escapes so many real-world situations that would have gone much worse if they were being realistic. It's actually, I think, a little bit, you know, dangerous to represent situations that way to anyone who's watching, right? Mylene Cruz is the only character here living a fairy tale, and we'll see if she ends up having a tragic end or a fairy tale ending. We'll see. But I don't like that aspect at all. Then we're getting into the next characters, and these are all basically the same, but you know, in terms of the level of my appreciating them, but I kind of still have them in order. But anyway, next is Fat Annie and Cadillac. I grouped them together, mother and son. The actors here are Lilias White and Yahya Abdul-Mateen II. But, you know, a show often is only as good, they say, or any entertainment property is only as good as its villains, right? And these are legitimate, good, creepy, disgusting villains. And the fact that these actors are willing to commit to being these characters and not try and cop out and be like, oh, well, deep down they're nice. They're like, nope, they're disgusting. I think it's really impressive. I love Fat Annie. I think all those scenes are very good. I like having a female crime boss, and I like that she does not act too much. Well, in some ways she acts like a female crime boss with Shaolin, but I think, you know, she seems legit. I like that. But I really like Cadillac. I love the character. His dance moves are both ridiculous and awesome at the same time. I love that he wrote his own disco song. I just think he's a great, stupid villain, but stupid villains, as you can see from the show, can often be the most dangerous. So I think he's excellent. I mean, as soon as I saw him, I thought he was a scary character, but I was just impressed that he never took his foot off the pedal, which is kind of like Cadillac in the reality of the show. Then next, Dizzee, of course, played by Jaden Smith. And, you know, it took me a couple of seconds to recognize Jaden Smith because with the afro, it just gives him a totally different look. But I do think that Jaden Smith has a very interesting look. I think that, you know, he's striking. He has a really striking face. You know, he's not particularly emotive, but of course they've used that to the character's advantage. I kind of was getting the feeling he was a gay character earlier on than it was revealed. And I think that, you know, and I was rooting for it, actually. When Thor showed up, I was like, you guys are a great couple. Go for it, guys. And, you know, when they were at the club, I was like, you both lucked out. You know, you both got really handsome guys, right? So I thought that was great. But I wasn't quite sure if it ended up being tokenism or not, right? Like, at first I was like, oh, cool, he's a legit member of this group. And he's an artist. He's an artist first. He's a member of the Fantastic Four plus one, or now the Get Down, right? He's a legitimate member. They don't even know that he's gay. So that just happens to be a part of him, his persona. But they've done so little to develop the character of Dizzee and to make you connect with the character personality-wise. And I don't know if that's the script's fault or Jaden Smith's fault. I think it's probably a little bit of both, that it does kind of seem a little tokenistic anyway. I also thought it was interesting. I don't know what Jaden Smith's sexuality is in real life, but his father, Will Smith, as you might recall, back in the day, one of his first major, serious roles was Six Degrees of Separation, where he played a character who was at least bisexual, and he shared a same-sex kiss in that movie. And it was a big deal, because, of course, he was coming from a mainstream show like The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. So I was wondering, considering how young Jaden Smith is signing on for this part, I'm sure he consulted his parents, and I wondered what kind of advice Will Smith gave him, and whether or not maybe this is even a type of part that Jaden Smith searched out because of what it was able to do for his father's career. Then next, Dizzee's brothers, Ra Ra and Boo Boo. I only know their names because I had to look them up when I was looking up the cast list. I think there may be some, in some points there were a little too many characters during the show. But I liked these characters. I thought that Skylin Brooks was great as Ra Ra, always explaining anything. Like, they call Zeke books. But I think that Ra Ra is plenty smart, and I'm glad that he was able to perform. But then with Tremaine Brown Jr., his character was a little annoying. Like with the crayon, that's what I wanted to talk about. I couldn't give it away. The crayon, and Tremaine Brown, like, wasn't taking it seriously, Boo Boo, and I was like, come on, Boo Boo. I don't even know why you're in this group. And also with the crayon, to me, as soon as he showed it, I was like, oh, it's to mark the records. But unfortunately, it took them a really long time to figure it out. But when he started to sing Michael Jackson style, I was like, just like they all was like, oh, that's why you're in the group. I was like, that's why you're on the show. So he won me over a little bit with his talent there. Then as for Mylene's friends and, these guys' sister, Yolanda, played by Stephanie Martin, and Regina, played by Shirley Rodriguez, I think they're great. They seem like backup singers. Like, when they were dancing around in the beauty shop, it seemed a lot to me like either Grease or West Side Story. So I think it's very well cast. But I think that those actresses, even though they seem like backup actresses, they still have a lot of personality and they pop. To be fair, even though these are a lot of characters, they all did strike. I think every secondary actor really, made their mark. Probably more, I think, than Jaden Smith, which is weird because he has a bigger part, but he didn't light up the screen quite as much as these other characters. But so I liked her friends. I thought they were fun. I also liked it when they were on the subway and Regina said, stop trying to save me, Mylene. Last I checked, we're on a subway heading into Manhattan to help you out. And I was like, oh, she got you. It's so true. So I thought that was nice. And then as for the Kipling parents, oh, I really liked them a lot. I thought they're played by Karen Aldridge and Ron Cephas Jones. I thought not only were they like really cool with their swag, right? But I liked their businesses, their beauty shop and their barber shop. I thought that was a really nice element there. I liked that they were such a big part of the community, which you could see by all the kids always coming over to their house, to their dinner table. I thought that was good. But then I thought they did a good job, even though these characters don't have a lot of screen time, although again, so stylish. Every time these two parents are on screen, I was like, you look amazing. But when they came back from their trip and the salons had been trashed, I thought they used them really effectively with the mom being like, I thought we had a better relationship with the community. And her sons, particularly Ra Ra, being like, you know what? I don't want my parents to feel that, everything was a lie based on my trying to protect myself with a genuine lie, for that a fake lie versus the real lie. And so I thought that was great. And I love that the mother was so grateful that her son didn't make her believe that, that lie that would have really eaten away at her and how she felt about her home, that she was like, don't punish him. The punishment will be fixing their mistake. So I thought that was a really great moment, a good teachable moment. But then as for Mylene's parents, they're awful and very unsympathetic. I know that Giancarlo Esposito is supposed to be like a big star here, for the show, but his character is so horrible. And, he's a holy man who's obviously just a walking, talk about a lie, right? With his past that's revealed and his the jealousy that he wants to be the star of his own church. I mean, it's really appalling, actually. I'll be curious to see what they try and do with this character, if they bother to redeem him, if he gets worse. I don't know. But also, I think even her mother, Sabrina Guevara, who, by the way, is Sarah Essen from Gotham. I was like, where do I know her from? So that's great. She's getting some more work. I liked her very much here. But while I don't understand why she would do what she's doing to Jimmy Smits's character, why it's so important for her to be with Giancarlo Esposito, because he treats her so horribly and he treats their daughter horribly. I can understand that Jimmy Smits is a criminal, but I don't think that Giancarlo Esposito's, you know, cultish church is any better. So it's weird to me that she would cause so much pain for so many individuals because of some oddly placed stubbornness. I mean, they haven't made me understand her character emotionally yet. She just seems kind of annoying, quite frankly. And now she's decided to go back and have an affair with Jimmy Smits again. I'm like, what? Okay, so anyway, don't like Mylene's parents at all. Then Zeke's aunt and uncle, you know, his aunt's boyfriend, Leon, you know, Judy Marte plays the aunt. She's fine. But I really like Brandon J. Dearden as Uncle Leon, not only because he has some funny lines, but he's from The Americans. And he's, talk about, again, range. On The Americans, he plays this really straight-laced, like, serious kind of nerdy guy. And so it's so funny to see him here, you know, like, really doing a fantastic job playing this, like, sweaty, cool, tough-talking, you know, always in his tighty-whities uncle. I think that's great. He's really good. Then we have two more to go. Then there's the teacher, played by Yolanda Ross, who sports amazing eyeshadow every scene she's in. But I think she did a very nice job. I think the most that she was able to do with her part is that she has to yell at Zeke a lot, but she doesn't make her character annoying. And that's tough to do. And then finally, Jackie Moreno, played by Kevin Corrigan. I mean, I guess the oral sex scene, you know, with, you know, his former intern turned record or tastemaker was kind of interesting in that they turned sexual harassment on its head. There's a horrible, inappropriate joke in there somewhere. But anyway, I thought that his character was just so stereotypical, and his being able to turn around was just so unrealistic. Like, he's an artist all of a sudden, right? Like, that didn't make any sense to me. And I'm surprised for someone who, maybe he hawked his Grammys for money, you know, because he said, I've got Grammys. I'm like, where are they? Why aren't they in the Hotel Chelsea anywhere? Although I did like that he lived there at the Chelsea Hotel, because that's where someone like him would have lived at that period. And I like the way they woke him up with the ice, you know, ice on his private parts. I thought that was a pretty good trick that Regina knew. But overall, his character was just so cliche. And just, you know, someone I think, he seems to be like someone you can't save, but he has good ideas on the spot, you know, when he decided to do like a disco religious song. That was pretty clever. He really literally saved his life there. But I don't know, his character's a little frustrating. And again, you know, he's not even realistic enough to make it interesting. You're just like, okay, I've seen this character so many times. What's he doing in this otherwise very original show? So that's my thoughts on The Get Down. I'd be curious to hear what you think of it. Be sure to write down below what you like about the show, what you don't like about the show, and, you know, what do you think of the opportunity that it's providing, not just to diversifying the landscape for entertainment, but also opportunities for non-white talent. All right, write your thoughts down below. Thank you so much, and you can check out some more episodes right now.